Good morning. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Memphis District 2017 observance of African-American Black History. My name is Lieutenant Colonel Brett Blackman. I'm the Deputy Commander of the Memphis District, and it's a pleasure to welcome you here today. I'll be serving as the MC for today's celebration. At this time, please stand with me for the playing of the National Anthem and remain standing for the invocation by Mr. John L. Wright for the District Equal Employment Opportunity Office. Thank you.
come to you as humble as we know how, thanking you for this day. Lord, we thank you for the opportunity to bring together people in your name. And Lord, we ask you to come right now and bless this program, not for entertainment value, but Lord, for it to be inspirational so it can help somebody along their way. Lord, we ask you to bless the speaker who's going to be speaking today so his words can touch somebody's heart. These things we ask in God's Son, Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
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 Please take your seats. The commander of the Army Corps of Engineers with this district, Colonel Michael A. L. Ellicott, will now present opening remarks for today's celebration. Ladies and gentlemen, Colonel Ellicott. Special welcome to Councilman Quill Boyd, Chairman of the MC Council. Thank you, sir. Appreciate it. Welcome to the celebration of Black History Month. This morning we will recognize African Americans' contributions that have made the country the greatest country in the world. Here are a few notable recent contributions. From 1989 to 1993, General Colin Powell, proven expertise and leadership, earned him both his position as the first African American to chair the Joint Chiefs of Staff and then leading the Victory Desert to stunning victory in Operation Desert Storm. And again, in 2001 to 2005, he served as the nation's first African American Secretary of State during the Battle of War. In 1992, Dr. Mae Jemison became the first African American woman to go to space for the space shuttle Endeavour, leading on cutting edge technology and scientific research. 2005, following General Colin Powell, Condoleezza Rice succeeded as the first African American female Secretary of State, facing the diplomatic challenges of the world of shifting power. Your individual leadership forged a path of opportunity which culminated in the election of the first African American president of the United States, President Barack Obama. Issues deemed as success always leaves footprints. The only footprints greater filled than those of the office of the President of the United States, those of an astronaut, those of the General and Chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, and those of the Secretary of State, but those of a hero like Mr. Samuel Tucker. As described in a century of Mississippi, the history of Memphis District, Mr. Samuel Tucker is a hero. During the flood of 1927, as the levees were breaking, Mr. Sam Tucker, a Memphis District employee, spent the day fixing levees by hand, fighting that flood and its devastation. At the end of a long day, Mr. Tucker and others watched the horror as a crew boat carrying 21 men foundered and sank in water, rushing through a crevasse, a break in the levee. Those who witnessed the disaster could not believe that anyone could survive such a tragedy. No one was willing to break that levee break and the storm to search for survivors. No one except for Mr. Sam Tucker. He unhesitatingly jumped into a skiff and took that skiff directly to the leg break. Rowing with the expertise of someone raised in the river, shot through the break, remaining drifted down the current on the other side, dodging obstacles and listening for sounds of survival. He found the only two survivors in that tragedy, Julius Elder and Oscar Clemens, in a thicket of willows, clinging tenaciously against wind and currents. Sam pulled into the skiff and began rowing the current in the dark and uncertain night, but against heavy current and near impossible weather. His return trip to safety 3 hours. I challenge each and every one of you to take every opportunity to positively impact the lives of those around you, regardless of your differences. This is the United States of America, a land of unparalleled opportunity filled with people that have the bravery and character to make the impossible possible. People like Mr. Sam Tucker. Success is always going to leave footprints, especially in the United States of America.
Shelby County Sheriff's Office, Ms. Grace Bond, representing Chief Policy and Compliance Officer Deborah Fessenden. From the Memphis City Council, Mr. Verlin Boyd, who's the Council Chairman. Council Chairman, and I would add the son of former Memphis District employee Verlin Boyd. From the Military Insurance Processing Station, or MEPS, here in Memphis, Major John Flores and Senior Chief Johnson. And Mrs. Christina Smith, the Director of the Federal Trust Credit Union here.
thank you, please be seated. At this time, Ms. Frankie Wade-Whitmore, Equal Employment Opportunity Manager from the USACE Finance Center in Wilmington, Tennessee, will now come forward and read the purpose of the African American Black History Observance.
Men and women throughout history. Since its inception, Black History Month has always been celebrated in the month of February. The theme is success always leaves footprints. When Kotchi Woodson established Negro History Week in 1926, he realized the importance of providing a theme to focus the attention of the public. The attention has never been to dictate or limit the exploitations of the Black experience, but to bring the public's attention to the important developments that merit emphasis. Over the years, the themes reflect the changes in how people of African descent in the United States have viewed themselves, the influence of the social on radical ideas and the aspirations of the Black community. African American history is rich in centuries-old efforts in dealing with the educational path of empire. The rise of the Black colleges and universities after the Civil War, unrelenting battles in the courts, the Black History Movement, the freedom schools of the 1960s, and local community-based academic mentorship programs that inspire a love of learning and a thirst for achievement. Black History Month, American history.
Thank you, Ms. Whitmore. At this time, I'm greatly pleased to introduce the Memphis District Choir, led by Mr. Thomas Burscher. These employees have rehearsed from their own time over the past several weeks and months to prepare for today's celebration. To the members of the choir and to Mr. Mercer, I say thank you.
You are
important.
Experience of the Black Church. He also served as the pastor of Canaan
Missionary Baptist Church in Covington, Tennessee from 1992 to February of 2016. Cana Missionary Baptist Church is a 148-year-old and its place is listed on the National Register of Historic Places by the United States Department of Interior. He and his wife, Gloria, are proud parents of Clarissa, Lisa, Vanessa, and Larry. Ladies and gentlemen, we speak for the hour, Dr. William Jones.
Choosing to be mastered by our going to. And I hope you're not going to let your circumstance master you. I remember I went real fast at first, and I had an experience that happened to me that slowed me down and gave me time to really think about my life and think about what I was going to be. I graduated from high school. I was 16 years old. I left home going to college at 16. At 19, I had completed 3 years of engineering school. I was 19 years old, a senior in college. I was scheduled to graduate in May. And this was an earth-shattering experience for me. I had a professor named Dr. Carson. He taught me metallurgy. That's what he, all the metals and carbons and space gas and materials and all that stuff. How you make metals hard, steel, the bridge they deal and all that. They put so much carbon in that metal and make it hard. I was going to the final exam. I had an 87 average taking the final exam. Dr. Parson graduated from Murphy Polytech Engineering School back in 1923. He taught metallurgy. And I was writing real fast, and I misspelled iron. And I was scheduled, this was taking the final exams. I was scheduled to graduate. Really? channel, the Mississippi River. Some of you all don't know that. But they had to move the channel of the Mississippi River over. Went out of it. I think they said a drag out in the middle of the river. For 2 years, dredged the channel. So, you know, the channel has to be 300 feet wide, 9 feet deep. That was a basic channel there. But they moved the channel of the Mississippi over so that they could put that bridge there. Now, what they did dikes. You know, you see dikes now. I mean, build up. And what out of them, people, all of the schools and homes, was just little trees. Nothing but little trees. But anyway, they moved this channel over. And so that the dredgers still get together 2 years so that they could build that bridge. We lost five people, I think, one of the coffinals collapsed while they were building the bridge, and five people had drowned. But anyway, that was exciting to me. I tell people, now, oh, you know, you take more credit for what you really did. I went out there working on survey part. Yeah. Oh man, I helped build that bridge. Well, if they didn't have proper survey, they couldn't have built the bridge. But anyway, some of you may know about the Bird Point New Mexico floodway. I was a project engineer on that project when they first got it. I wrote the first plan survey on the Bird Point New Mexico floodway. I still have it on my desk. It was about that thick, but now the environmental statements are that thick. And that was quite an experience. They had the sinking plan, the map plan, the dredges, grading units. We had 1,500 employees employed in the metrication. Quite a difference. There was an engineer here named Tom Gaff. Some of y'all may remember Tom Gaff a year ago. Tom Gaff made a statement. And it's true. And it should be true for you or anybody. If you hate your job so bad that you just have to put a gun to your head, work in the morning, I have one question for you. Why would you spend the best years of your life doing something that you hate to do? Why? Why would you do that? Tom Gallagher made that statement. He loved his work. They sent Tom Gallagher and I out on surveys, and Tom Gallagher had a little problem. I was a young engineer, and I told him I can't do that. But anyway, so I'm saying, I said, why would you do that? I give you some options. And I'm sure all of you know that. Everybody can be an engineer. Engineering is hard. It was very difficult for me. Very difficult. You have to take college algebra for a year, calculus for a year, differential equations. By the time you get through differential equations, if you weren't half enough, you were completely by the time you got through differential equations. So everybody can't do that. And by the time you get through strength of materials, hydraulics, and all of that stuff, by the time you get through all of that, it's more than a pipe dream about being an engineer. But I want to tell you something to you may know, and you may not know. I hope you know. There's no limit to self-improvement. Now he keep talking about me, but to get my point over, it must be. I didn't know what I would do or what I would end up doing. First of all, I had a family. So my first obligation was to provide for them at all costs. So for 20 years, I worked two jobs. I was a pastor and a engineer. I would come up here and work 8 hours, leave here and go to the University of Memphis, take my graduate course. Oh, by the way, I was the first flight to be enrolled in graduate school engineering at the University of Memphis. And then the family said, you didn't have school. But anyway, I would go and take those. There were many days I left home at 6 o'clock in the morning and got back at 10 o'clock at night because I knew that it was going to take more than what would require. Some people have the attitude. You military guys know, no. Second place is never an option in any military operation. Because second place on the battlefield, you're dead. So there are opportunities here that you may not even know about. I'm going to make sure you know what you can do. If you want to better yourself, and it's job related, the company will pay for you to go to school. One of my master's degrees, the one that I got from the University of Memphis, didn't cost me one dime. Only thing it cost me was time. And I made my mind. I was going to do my time. Because I had got selected as the EO officer. I said, now, they may have selected me because I was a better, you know, some stuff you did because you just sent it away. And ain't nobody speak but you. They just grab you by the collar and drag you on. So I knew I had to do something to make myself better qualified. So I got a master's in personnel and counseling and program administration. So when he came to me, oh, okay, he all right. When I was called to preach, first night of preaching, I knew, I knew that people don't like dummies trying to tell them what to do. Nobody wants to listen to someone who's looking for Hebrews in the Old Testament. Nobody wants to listen. Nobody wants to listen to someone like that. So what did I do? I went to school day and night until I got my master's and then until I was in there. And I said, this ain't enough. I enrolled at LBU and got my number. Now, the church that I pastored, they were looking for someone that had an education. It was an old historic church. When I went there, I applied, and they had 27 applicants. I was the only one with two master's degrees. They put all of the other back, and they chose me. Now, let's get back to what we're talking about, because I don't want to go too far. But I'm saying, think about this. And I don't want to seem too hard. But one thing I like to do, I like to remain positive. I like to deal with reality. If you go to the doctor and get a physical, say what's bothering you. And what he or she does is based on what you say. And they may want to dial in attention after you tell them, but you have to give them some kind of idea of what is. Now, getting back to us and our responsibility. Listen to me good. If you hear nothing else I'm saying, this is true in anything you do. Responsibility. Holding ourselves accountable for what we manifest in our lives is about ownership. Recognizing our ability to choose between right and wrong. We should not waste valuable time and energy placing blame on others. Listen to this, by the quote I love offering. The most worthwhile endeavor that I have ever undertaken is responsibility for my own life. It's hard and it's worth it. If you haven't had a promotion in 15 years, you need to do one or two things. First of all, the only way you can see reality is you have to look in mirrors, not wonders. When you look in wonders, you see everybody else. When you look in mirrors, like Michael Jackson said, a man in the mirror gotta change his way. I would love to look in the mirror and see a guy that instead of weighing 200, weighed about 195, with cold black hair, you know, and all this stuff. But when I look in the mirror, I see an old gray-headed man that's been around a long time. The reason I say this, and I guess I may quit telling my age eventually, but if I'm blessed by someone who has more power than me, on July the 20th, I'll be 75 years old. And that's something to think about. I still go to the gym 5 days a week. I work out, I take care of myself, my wife is a dietitian, and I eat so much lettuce, I feel like I'm a rabbit. I'm telling you, it's amazing. See, I'm not forgetting that, but vegetables, fruits. But let me tell you something before you laugh. And you don't get around, I'm almost finished. 3 years and 4 years ago, I weighed 254 pounds. I went to the doctor. He said, the doctor told me, I want you to lose down to 210. So you're diabetic. Look over. finish. We don't know who we influence by our actions. One thing that I know, some of us have learned this the hard way. Everything you do, somebody's looking at you, somebody see you, they know what you're doing, they know all about you. And they may not mention it till it's the critical time where it can hurt you the most. So that's why we are role models. When I say we, I'm talking about everybody in this role model. Because all of y'all got jobs that folks would just love to have. They would love to have a job. I know a young man. You may have children who do the same thing. They want to be what their parents are. Like a little boy, success means footprints. The little boy, you see him walking around the room, putting on daddy's shoes, putting his feet in daddy's shoes, says, I want to be just like my daddy when I grow up. Parents don't ever tell your child that never be anything, but that will become a self-fulfilling prophecy. And when you tell him he's not going to be anything, and he's the end of the 201 popular birthday, they're going to say, my mom and dad told me I wasn't going to be nothing. Tell him, senator, mayor, whatever. I know this young man. He's an excellent student. An excellent basketball player. He's about 6'5". And that way. Excellent basketball player. Many colleges are offering scholarships as soon as they finish high school. But you know what he says? He talks about it all the time, but I talk to him. I don't want to play in the NBA. You know what he says? I want to be like my daddy, who is a college professor with a PhD. And Harvard offered him a scholarship. He said, I want to be like my daddy, PhD. Are we doing things for our children? Want to be like us. Who knows? I may want to be a colonel in the sergeant or something. You know, maybe. Now, you have to understand, we can't have more colonels and more sergeants. We have to have some enlisted men too. But I'm saying, you would be very surprised. And I mean, very surprised. The amount of influence that you have on people around you. A person is known by the company he or she keeps. My mother told me when I went to college, she said, boy, let me tell you something. Hang out with the students that are making A's and B's. Don't run around with the ones that are making D's and F's. Yeah, well, I know how to make an F all by myself. I don't need no help. I hung around students to study. They called me, my nickname, they called me Book. Some of y'all may not believe me. But when I was at Tennessee State, there was not a student on the campus that studied more than me. Not one. Now, let me give that grace, because I wouldn't give it. But I knew it took an effort on my part. They don't call to read something to you. Like I say, there's so much that I told is the core of your image, especially in meditation. To me, it's one of the best places in the world. The word. Now, honestly and sincerely, feel like that. You don't read the ER for 27 years and hate to do it. If I walk into someone and they tell me, oh, you just put it on, probably got me better than anybody else. But you tell me, when a supervisor makes a suggestion, make yourself better qualified than any of that on the list. You tell me, what supervisor, I'm not talking about discrimination and all of that, I'm not talking about all of that. I'm talking about your ownership. You tell me what supervisor, well, look on the list and say, if he does, he's not going to tell you. I bet you won't tell the problem there. I'm just trying to get a particular person. He's going to have in his mind, understood, I'm looking for the best qualified person. So what you do, you make it very difficult for him to come up with a reason not to select you. Make him explain why. You're the one spending all this time. You did this, you did that, you did that. And it's, you know, it's hard to explain stuff like that if you can't come up with the right reason. So I encourage you, I'm going to read this. I mean, just like I did in my shop. You said you're going to quit 10 minutes ago. You still going. But I'm going to read this and I'll finish. I want you to keep in mind. When you begin a great work, you can expect to finish it all. You can't expect to finish it all at once. Therefore, do your best to press on. And let nothing discourage you till you have entirely finished what you have begun. Writing a book, earning a degree, losing weight, developing a relationship, all take time. Sometimes, in the middle of working toward a goal, we lose our motivation. We tell ourselves, we're bored, or tired, or just can't do it. But what may really be going on is that we are afraid. It's okay to feel afraid. It's human. And it's good for us to know how we feel. Then we can do something about it. We may need a rest. It's okay to take time and rejuvenate ourselves before we move forward. We also can seek support and encouragement from family, friends, and higher power. We can turn to the universal love and wisdom that's in our heart and let us encourage each other. Then we are ready. We can gently press on. That means breaking down the tasks into simple, manual activities. Take them one step at a time. Before you know it, you have reached your goal. Our goal was not to talk too long. I could have preached a long time, but I'm not trying to get anybody to help. I just don't want you to say, wow, I'm glad he's sitting down. Thank you very much.
Get quiet, man. I want to want you to look at your neighbor right now and say, I don't know about you. Come on. I don't know what you're going through. But things are going to get better. How many of y'all believe that? How many of y'all believe that? Y'all put your hands together. Come on. When I say put your hands together, that means it is.
Appreciate the time that you took with that.
Thank you for having me here. I'd like to give a quick token of our appreciation. I'm going to give you a Memphis District Church. You probably have at least one, maybe two of these. But I have one more for you. So, size for your current size, not your previous size. So, I'll show you how. So, that's a different thing. I feel like many of you. Thank you very much for your kind words. I appreciate it. I do want to stand up real quick. At the end of this, you, myself, and Jim are going to get a quick picture. But before you sit down, one more round of applause.
This time, please rise and join the Memphis District Choir as we sing "Lift Every Voice and Sing" and find the words to the song.